You're listening to the Go Lightly Martial Hour on freedomtalkradio.net. FreedomTalkRadio.net.
Hi guys.
Hello. And yes, I do hate homosexuals and am homophobic. And that's pigs, isn't it? Homophobic, brother. And Jewophobic.
Totally.
I'm Christianophobic. I'm Muslimophobic. What else is there?
Not a lot.
What about I love women.
Hi guys in the chat room, good to see you there, John, Patrick and Eric and Anna. Well, what an interesting 24 hours, 48 hours it has been, and I just thought, I'm actually lost for words.
No.
Something's going
on. What date
is it? Actually, you reminded me. What date is it? Hello, Rodney. Good to have everybody in the chat room. And all those who are listening
live. You're talking to sleep. How can you be lost for words?
I did not talk in
sleep. How do you know?
what I wanted to say. Oh, get the date out of it. Wait, what is it? Today is July the 29th, 2015. It's 12:05 and we are broadcasting from the home of the Lord Jesus Christ, Brian Lenniger Lightning Martial.
Who is homophobic.
Who is
and
totally
Jewophobic.
Totally.
And Christianophobic.
Yes.
And Muslimophobic.
Yes. In other words...
They're all dead meat.
Totally. God is righteousness, love and righteousness, truth and intelligence. Religion binds. And as Jesus, I want to make a correction too, because when we go, let's go over to some of the headlines. There's four of them that Gabe posted. Rodney says, hello all. Well, in the last 2 hours, I've had to approve over 30 new members wanting to join the group from all over the earth. That is good news. And seriously, it is the grassroots. So I know some have been thinking that the article is slanted against us. I'd say the opposite. It's slanted for us. And Liam Quinn, whether he knows it or not, did a great job. And because I went over to Liam Quinn and said, you've done a great job, Liam, what nobody else could do, and quoted Protocol 14, we shall forbid Christ, somebody picked up that from a tweet by the name of Shane from Ireland, who has, he's into media and blogs and whatever, that he asked us, for his email, he wants to do a follow-up and help spread the message. So it's the grassroots, it's always the people in the marketplace, as Jesus, that's who he walked amongst. And so to make a correction for everybody, as we read the...
But how many dimensions are there?
There's the fifth dimension, the group. Oh dear.
Since they come up with the idea of quantum mechanics... There's an Irish Canadian that came up with the idea that if you do this here, it happens on the other side of the universe simultaneously. This is the split twin light forming through a prism, all sorts of shit they get up with. And when they get into quantum mechanics, you've got to keep on making new dimensions, because you've got to make the math fit. It's all bullshit. You've got a gun, bang, in the head, you're into the other dimension. So you've got the dead dimension where the souls are now either in heaven or in hell. Right, so you've got those dimensions, and then you've got the earth. Occasionally you see a ghost walking around, I've seen several, and angels, of course. You could say they're in their own dimension, but in reality it's only because you're blinded to it. They're with you, and you just can't see it. So, say that you're blind to their reality. They're not blind to yours. You have angels with you all the time, in fact. But going into this idea of 14 dimensions is utter rubbish. 12 dimensions is rubbish. 8 dimensions is rubbish. You keep on going down. The true reality is you've got death and life.
It's really very simple.
Yeah.
The KISS principle, keep it simple, stupid. To get involved in the science of today is to go down huge rabbit holes and lead you away from the simplicity of the truth, which is to...
Well, it's all Jewish inspired, because they have to come up with an alternative to the Christ. That's why they, in the Protocol 14, is we will forbid Christ. They're saying we will forbid the man himself on the earth. That's what it means. We will forbid Christ. How can you forbid Christ? Well, they're doing it. They're blocking and holonetting and stopping you from hearing what I say. And it's also absurd to think that I have to go to such lengths to be regarded as some sort of a crank because I tell the truth. I'm the only man on earth that's telling you the truth.
Mm.
Yet I'm a cult leader for doing that. Which is fine. It just redetermined what the name of cult means, really.
Totally. Here we go. So we've got the Daily Mail we're all familiar with. These are the headlines that Gabe photo-captured. Australian Jesus tricked man into abandoning family, son-in-law says. Well, we covered that very thoroughly with John's wonderful Skyping yesterday, which had a profound effect on a lot of people. Fear, get a load of this one. This is from theexpress.co.uk. Fear grows as homophobic Australian cult leader who claims to be Christ gains, and it goes dot, dot, dot. It says he has published online a letter he claims is from former Pope Benedict, as well as images of his face transposed. And then there's another one from The Inquisitor 21 hours ago. Australian cult leader believes he is the second coming of Jesus and one, dot, dot, dot. And then during one of his videos, he even shares a letter that he claims is from Pope Benedict. In the letter, he is dot, dot, dot. And then here is the one. This is from Pink News 20 hours ago.
Oh, I just put my lipstick on at the time.
People around the world really believe this homophobe is Jesus. People are traveling. Now, you know I'm the editor, so I've got to read it the way it's written. People are traveling the globe in border to join a cult run by an extreme homophobe who genuinely believes he is Jesus. Well, they've got that right. He is an extreme homophobe. And I'm delighted that everybody's picking up on the Christ Comforter Father, King of Kings, Lord of Lords, Brian Lenigo, Lightly Marshall. In the flames, you know, BLGM is going to take back his rainbow. And the LGBT.
The word gay really annoyed me when I first realised I was using that for homosexuality.
Mm.
And then the rainbow. Oh, Mary.
Mary, Mother of God.
Anyway,
so that's the... If there's any more out there that you find, please let us know. Because again, you know, not a lot is turning up on our pages.
Remember, we're holonetted, so
yeah. And it's only if I go over to... I went over and I was surprised by the activity on Twitter. We've got 6 more followers. And this Shane from Ireland who wants to do a follow-up. Now, what is also interesting... Let me see if I can get there without interfering.
To say I'm an Irish, it's got the highest standard of education in Europe, and some of the smartest people come over on. There is one thing, though, that sort of knocks it on its ass, really, that I think it might have been Dublin or something like that, where they built a tunnel, billions of pounds, under the city for the European trucks that were coming over to go through Ireland and delivering their goods, right? So they built this thing, and then when it was finished, the following year, the new truck laws in Europe made them a metre higher, and it couldn't fit under the bloody tunnel. So now they've got this beautiful tunnel built under Dublin or something like that, maybe it's Belfast, and the trucks from Europe can't go under it. So they had to go through the town where they was going, ruining the bloody town because all these big heavy trucks are rocking the shit out of everything, and all these sacred buildings and old buildings are falling down, right, because of the vibration of those trucks. So there's got this huge tunnel underneath. The dumb bastards didn't realise they should have made it a metre higher. Well, an Irish friend of mine who had come over to visit told me that, and he just laughed his head off at dumb man. But on the other hand, they have the highest education standard in the world.
Right.
And a lot of people go there to be educated.
Yes, yeah. And their sense of humour is often.
Sense of humour.
All right, so we've got John Lynch. Hello, John. And Mark Saxon, you're in the chat room as well. Hello, boys. Mark says, my grandmother was from Dublin and the other one from Belfast. Yes, and of course, your grandparents were from Durham, weren't they?
Durham. Yeah, but that's Scotland. That's on the border of England and Scotland.
Oh, Durham.
On the Reggie side, Maloney.
Right, that's right, Maloney. Mm. Yeah. Anyway,
so Durham. Brian is also, why do they call me Brian? Well, it's the most famous Irish king.
Yeah, and of course, we drove along the Brian Jordan Drive when we took a drive up to the New Jerusalem declared by De Quiros in 1606 at Gladstone, and we crossed the Jordan River over to the island called Brian Jordan, and then the other river named not far away is Salvador. So
strange taxi driver at the Dublin airport get in the car and they rush off, and he comes to a red light and he just accelerates straight through. And the guy in the back, of course, he's terrified. What the hell's going on? You know, we're in Dublin and wherever, and we're going through red lights.
Yes.
Huh? What's wrong? He said, don't worry. He says, my brother, he's a taxi driver for 30 years. He taught me how to drive. And he always goes through the red light. So he comes to green light and he comes to screaming out. He said, what happened? He said, my brother might be coming the other way. That's a true story.
Oh, very, very funny.
Follow me, I'll be behind you all the way, they say.
Now, the other exciting thing... Patrick, I read through your website. What an interesting man you are. And I was thinking, John Lynch. Patrick, you heard John Lynch's story, sad story about the house that he bought that shouldn't have been sold to him in the first place. Because it should have been.
Because he's as high as a roof. He's a huge geezer, right?
6 foot 4. At the Hobbit House.
Hits his head on all the doorways.
Patrick, as a realtor where you are, is there anything that you can do to help John Hall out of his...
Heavily insure and torture.
Hey, that's a point, John Lynch. You know, insurance companies are all Jewish. Torch the place. Make sure you've got your coverage up to date first. Anyway, interesting thing is that the radio show, two shows ago, so it was show 348 that I called Thy Kingdom Come, it now has 800...
It's been and gone, right?
Yeah, well, the kingdom's been and gone. Anyway, it has had 801 plays this morning, the last time I checked, up from 741 yesterday. Shock the living day. Because as you know, if we get 90 plays at a time, that's good, but... All this week they've been going up and up and up, even before the liar...
Don't warn the Jews, because I'll go and put the numbers down.
Yeah, even before the liar was lit, there you go, the fire was lit.
I have got a lot of affection for Jews, especially the homosexual ones in Tel Aviv.
Oh, really? Yes.
Yeah.
What are you going to do with them?
Burn them.
Throw another Jew on the barbie. Anyway, we're having a little bit of fun here at the expense.
I don't really mean that about the Jews. Don't bother sending the police out.
The swedge.
That's a joke.
Because he's the
same as the ashtray, the Volkswagen, Hitler designed it, you know. I told you that joke yesterday, didn't I?
As everybody knows.
And the Jews, can you get the Volkswagen?
The 500 bit, or the four in the Volkswagen, the 500 in the ashtray.
Yeah, four in a seat and 500 in the ashtray.
Yeah. Anyway, Of course, we all know the ones that call themselves Jews today are not Jews anyway, all the European Jews.
They're all Khazars.
They're
back in Mongolia, for fuck's sake.
These are the synagogue of Satan, who sacrifice your babies. And the body parts that we're just... this is what the abortion industry is all about. And everything to do with sacrificing it's all Jewish. Abortion is totally Jewish.
So that's why the Catholics don't have birth control and they don't have abortion.
Yeah.
Right? That way you get more Catholics and less abortions, right? That's the old idea of it.
So there's
the rhythm method is called, if you want to have birth control.
There's some corrections to the headlines going around.
I got rhythm. I got my gal.
And of course...
I got rhythm. Who can ask for anything more?
Serious matters, my goodness gracious. The serious matter is that the headlines... The headlines are all...
Gentlemen, just go pause your thoughts here.
The headlines need editing. He doesn't think or believe that he's the Son of God at all. He's God Almighty. Hello?
Yeah,
hello? And he is the
Been
comforter.
Been there, done that.
Yes. Yes, it was never Jesus coming back. So all these wankers
the
out there, he believes he's the Son of God. No, he isn't. He's not the Son at all. He was, but he's back this time as the big kahuna, the father. It's all about his judgment, and the judgment is in. There are several genres, if you want to call them, of people on the planet who have to go. They offend him greatly. Of course, we're talking about all the LGBTs and the swedge out there, the hyenas. The parasites, whatever you like to call them, the maggots.
Child molesters, homosexuals.
Yes.
Matter of fact, we had a lovely lady who discovered me by putting into her cell phone, I think, God. And it came up with me.
Yes, she was looking for God. Right. She Googled God.
And she immediately abandoned everything and come up here. But she's got a daughter that's a raging lesbian. And while she was staying up here with us, she's a lovely, lovely lady, but had a hell of a life. And as it turns out, she finally realises what I'm saying about gays. No chance. And it panicked her so much that she left here to go live with the daughter. And then because of
not,
all
not live with her, but to be near her.
To be near her.
The daughter, the lesbian, was going through a time of crisis and based on her own...
The daughter of dildo on eBay, you know.
Don't even go there. Yes, everything is all Jewish ritual murder. We
and K-Jill,
What?
K-Jill?
No,
have you got K-Jill?
No, I don't want to know anything about this, please. Somebody else out got something out there. What are we going to talk about today?
Well, we're doing all right so far.
The demoralisation.
Oh,
that's it. That's what you wanted to talk about. The bullshit of carbon 14. Now, I just want to tell the world, I'm going to be 59, in a couple of weeks. And when I was in primary school... And, the early years of high school. In our science then, we were told about the inaccuracy of carbon-14. Because, you know, you're going back 45
What happens
years
is
ago.
The rays from the sun come in and I think they hit the helium and change it to something other. And the percentage of it that's in the atmosphere would be equivalent to taking a pound of gold, powderizing it and sprinkling in the atmosphere, then trying to find a bit, right, in the entire world. And over a period of time, the animals apparently eat the vegetation and grass and so forth. And because the carbon-14 gets into the growing of plant life, and because you eat the animal, or you eat the grass, or you eat the corn, or whatever. And over your lifetime, you build up a level of carbon-14 that can be measured at 5,730 years is the half-life of it. So in other words, if they watched you for that length of time, you should have dispersed as carbon-14 back into the atmosphere. That's in your blood, or bones, or whatever. Okay. Now, it's determined by several factors, that the weather conditions don't change, and that you have a steady flow of sunlight from the Earth to the Earth, and that hits the atmosphere, which hits the helium, which changes that to a carbon atom or something like that. I didn't really read it. It's so stupid. I can't do this sort of thing. It just really pisses me off. And so places like Australia has more sunlight, should have more carbon, right? Or places like Antarctica should have none at all, or or the Arctic Circle. So the idea is that the carbon-14 circulates through the northern hemisphere and it comes down to the equator, but unfortunately the airs don't mix there. You've got the southern hemisphere and you've got the northern hemisphere, and you've got different weather conditions and different angles at the sun and different distances to the sun, so therefore you should have more carbon in one area than you do in another. And therefore the animals that eat there should be able to consume more carbon, so that animal that you eat gets into your body over your lifetime, and therefore you carbon date you when you die, and you've got to listen to how old you are. Okay, the percentages are 0.00000 around 7. I mean, they can't even get that right, of the atmosphere. So it's not very much. So we get to the point of carbon dating anything, and a snail has been carbon dated at 27,000 years old and is still alive. That's the shell of its back. Other animals that recently died, like the day before, a seal, that was over 100,000 years old. And this is what the carbon dating comes up with. So where's this all going? Well, when they went to the moon, they come back and they have another way of carbon dating, but it's argon dating or something like that. And it also has a half-life. But there's no atmosphere on the moon, so there's a bit of a different quality.
So when you say they went to the moon, because they didn't walk on the moon.
No, they didn't. But in their minds, they're saying they took rocks back from the moon and they tested them, because it never happened, right? They never went to the moon, they never brought rocks back. They just went out in the Mojave Desert, got some rocks and started measuring them there, right? So they'd come up with 4.5 billion years old for the moon. So why are we doing all this? Well, the evolutionists are trying to push back time, so that you evolved out of a primordial soup with a lightning strike or something like that. And at the end of the day, you ask them, well, is your parent a rock? Did you evolve out of a rock? Well, there's no evolutionary thought that covers the actual first bit. They say, well, yes, you've changed from a sea slug to this, to this, to this, to this, to this, to this, and finally, you got me. Or, what was the first life from? What caused the first amino acids? No answer. So you can sort of throw that all out the window. But this is taught in your schools, and you're paying for it. Intelligent design, on the other hand, shows where you've got one thing that's called a flagellum bacteria. 4 billion can fit in a little tiny thimble like that. And sticking out of it, some of them in three different parts, has a little whip tail. That's why it's called a flagellum. And it spins at 100,000 revolutions per minute. And in 1/4 of a turn, it can stop and go the other way. So the little thing is just going around doing its thing, looking for other flagellums to mate with, or whatever the hell they do. And these things are very complex. But in the driving mechanism, they call it... the most efficiently designed electrical or neutron motor. I mean, you read all these things, I forget the different terms they use, really. But it's made up of 40 components. So if you was to build an electric motor or a refrigerator or whatever, you've got to have, say, in a motor, you've got to have a bearing, you've got to have a shaft, you've got to have a rotor, you've got to have an outside bit, and they're all got to be assembled in a particular order. So, in the flagellum, there's 40 components that are dragged out of the primordial soup of the cell of the amino acids and proteins and all this kind of thing. They form one bit, and then they form the next bit, and then they form the next bit until it's got to this perfect motor. Then a little tail on the end of it, then it starts spinning. It's done that in about half a second. It is so fast. And then these little things are zoom about doing their thing, whatever they want to do. They do have a collective intelligence that have a purpose, and that is to become able to be broken up at the death part. And their bits are then in the primordial soup, which can be gathered by something else to make something else, right? Out of the DNA. So complex that there's no human being could look at it, even comprehend remotely, that this is what Darwin even had in mind when he considered that we have evolution from one species moving along slightly, altering to the environment, like the finches on the Galapagos Island. I think there's, what, something, 16 finches or something. One's got a longer beak, one's got a shorter beak. I mean, who cares? They're all birds. They're all finches, aren't they? So he had no idea what a cell was. And now they've come up with what the cell is into the actual DNA and the viruses and all these things that go together to make up a very, very complex, wonderful creation that cannot be put together by some evolved thing out of a rock. So carbon-14 is bullshit. Evolution is bullshit. We know it's bullshit. Why? Well, it's taught in the universities and schools.
And the ones that teach intelligent design or creation is
not allowed to be taught in the school.
Are not allowed.
In
fact,
fired. That's right. If you are a professor and you teach one word of intelligent design, you get pulled out. You are sacked on the spot. You lose your tenure. Tenure is like a contract. Tenure contract for a brilliant scientist like Stephen Hawking, who is totally fucked in the head.
You can't
believe a word he says because you can't understand a word he said. Huh? They haven't got someone to interpret it for him. They go, someone's in sitting there interpreting.
Hey, listen, I was just scrolling through Chuka's videos and he had up there your interview with Stephen Hawking.
Put it up, let's hear it.
Well, now, guys, for those of you listening,
is that the one where I was doing James Bond's voice?
Oh, look, I'd have to take a couple of minutes to go back there. But I was actually looking, because we want to play the Revolution song. Now, somebody, it was either Chuka, it might have been Joel, or Dex or somebody. Somebody put Yah together and Revolution. Do you know the video that I'm talking about? I've gone through Chuka's... Well, I couldn't find it. The revolution where it's all focused about, we're going to have a revolution. I'm sure we were living at Harvey Bay at the resort.
I think so.
It might have been Dex that we're going to have a revolution.
Could have been Dex.
But does anybody know the video I'm talking about? If you do, and come up with the link quickly and post it to my Facebook page, I can't click onto a link from the chat room. But if you know what I mean, put it on my Facebook and we'll get it. In the meantime, if Diana was there, she would know. Diana, are you in the chat room? The revolution one. In the meantime, I'm going to play.
Don't leave by and look up dildo. They do have a battery operated one, too.
Oh, I don't even know what that is.
It spins a little tongue in it.
Let's think about Yah and listen to this. The word. There you go, tell me the evolution. Change the world. When you talk about destruction.
Yeah. There's also a foot operator do that, isn't it? And a bicycle do that, isn't it? Quite good, isn't it? Kevin now was supposed to swim across the Yangtze River or something, and Max Spitzka now. He's a Jew, by the way.
Max Spitz.
Kevin gold medal at the end of the
week.
Yeah. And world record. Look at this. Jay's a money boy, huh?
Oh. All things are good. Oh, right.
Well, there you go, eh?
All right.
Thanks for watching.
Yar is the revolution. Yeah, so again, reiterating, your boys in the chat room, John and Andrew, you know which video I'm talking about. The one of Yar set to revolution that one of you have done in the past. Pretty sure it was, I'm thinking about it, I think it was Dex now. All right, well, that's it for today's show. Hello, Andrew, you're there in the chat room. Who'd have thought God is a hippie? Are you a hippie, babe?
Well, my sister was a hippopotamus.
So what does that make you?
Big.
Oh, dear, oh, dear.
No, I don't think I've fallen into all those categories, but no.
Yeah, it's young.
I had a point at the time, hippies.
Yeah.
Now, for I went to Haight-Ashbury in 1967.
Yes.
And there's lots of strange things going there. That was on my way up to Canada.
Right.
And you drive through the place, there's all these people in their Volkswagen combis and the flowers all over the place, all dressed like men dressing like women. Long hair and big bell-bottom and flowers all over the pants and that sort of thing. So I thought, oh, I've got to get out of here. So I kept driving, went up in Vancouver, and I met a Canadian fellow on the way on the ship. And he had a friend, in, I think it might have been Burrard Road or Street or something in Vancouver. So we go to this house, and it was full of hippies. And the fellow that sort of was the main owner or renter of this place used to wear a, if you're familiar with Donald Duck, well, his Donald Duck's grandfather was
Scrooge. What was that?
Well, something to do with Donald Duck, but he wore a long coat, top hat, and spats on the boots, right?
Wasn't that Scrooge? This is how, his uncle.
Might have been Scrooge. But anyhow, this guy weighed 110 pounds and he was bench pressing 20 pounds in the gym. Well, I was doing about 400 at the time. And this guy was doing 20. He was doing the barbell with nothing on it.
Right.
As strange, all drugged out of their tree. And a little guy I was with, an Australian fellow, who was pretty macho sort of a guy. Ian Wilson, his name was. We're sitting around in this big room, and all these strange-looking characters, all in their flower power clothing and so forth. And he says, "Is there any virgins in the room?" So I said, "Where's this going?" You know. So I stuck my hand up because, after all, you've got to go along with the joke, right? And he said, "Well, no one's fucked me yet." That's what he said to all his characters, right? Although we're going to get beaten to death. They all laughed. That's what he said.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh.
Is there any virgins in the room?
And you say, hand up.
I stuck my hand up there. Well, naturally, I could see something was going to be said by Ian because he had a real mouth. But a little guy, big mouth, right?
Yes.
He'd been beaten up so many times. That's the kind of thing I put up with. Yeah. So that was my first taste of Canadians.
Really? Now, where did you say you went, Hate?
Well, was it Burrows or one of the main streets?
Burrows. But the name of the place that you said you went to for Haight-Ashbury or something like that.
Haight-Ashbury's in San Francisco.
Oh, right.
That was the sort of capital of the flower people at the time.
Oh, right. Okay. Mm. Because you arrived.
I arrived in Canada right on the end of 1967.
Right.
So it was either the 4 days before or 4 days after the New Year, something like that.
But weren't you there previously at the beginning of the 60s? When
67.
You first arrived?
First I arrived, 67.
67.
I was in Africa in 63.
Right, okay. And then, of course, your... didn't we find it? Your passport with the stamp and the visa?
Yeah, well, we found that.
From that debt, yes. Yeah.
Very interesting.
All the numbers, of course.
All the numbers are perfect, you know. You look up the sunrise and sunset and all that kind of stuff for the various places I've been in with a stamp on it. And it all told the story of what we're really doing today that is so complex, so wonderfully orchestrated by the heavenly realm. See, what we're living in today is just playing out what's already occurred, right? This is just a mirror image, right? But in the mirror image, you've got the opportunity to live your life over and over and over again until you reach this state of judgment, when God himself comes to the earth. That's why I've raved on a bit about and trying to explain. I give up really sometimes because I just don't get it. We have the baby's dream creates a parent, the father, to create the mother and father out of the side of the, in a baby's mind of brilliance, all-knowing, if you like, in the pre-embryonic state of creation. The baby doesn't realize that when he thinks it creates, right? So it created the father, and out of the father created the mother, because she's dreaming up a perfect parent. And then the swirling of the dancing throughout time and space is something that you could do a lovely painting about. But it all comes down to how do you get life in a matter situation? Well, you've got to create atoms and time. That time and atoms are hand in hand. You can't have atoms without time. So the time then is what enables a positive and negative charge, if you like, to circulate around and be pulled together, because the creation split a magnetic field of sorts to create atoms with a neutron, a proton and an electron, and that's hydrogen, right? So you go to the hydrogen number times pi is 3168 in the original term. So then when you get the creation of the Earth, let's get from one point now down to we've got the creation of the Earth. You've got the distance to the tip of South America. You take that number times pi is 3168. So you get where I'm born. I have to be in Rothschild, haven't you? Because I've got to identify who the beast is, right? So it's Rothschild. And the distance to the South Pole is 3875 miles. Now, what the hell is that? Well, you've got to take your Word of God, which everyone thinks the Word of God, which is the King James Bible. It's not the Word of God. It's only you think it is. What it is the Word of Numbers, which is the Word of God.
Mm.
Okay? Doesn't matter what it says. It's a book of numbers. So you look it up, you've got to have a concordance. Well, this is the greatest trap of all time, because the Jews had the concordance way back in time. And then an American came up with it, with 100 scholars, James Strong's in the 1830s or 78 or something like that, and created 8674 words in the Old Testament. Right? Oh, lovely. What's that mean? Well, if you call that days, it's 3.168 years. Hello?
So 8.674 day.
So then you get 5624 words in the Old New Testament. Why? The New Testament is explaining the Old Testament with less words. That's a pretty good trick, I thought. And so you subtract that number from the first number and it gives you 350, which is Yah. Only found once in the Old Testament, in Psalms. Yah is taken out of the New Testament. Hello? You think it'd be put in a lot more time, but it is. It's not. It's taken out. So when it's taken out, you've got to say, hello, why? Well, you just go back through time and you see that the area of where the Bible started to come together, who was in charge of it? Well, by that time, it was, of course, Jews. They sometimes call them dipped Jews. They're not really Christian. They've just been dipped and wink-wink, become a priest to influence. And that's what the Jesuits are all about. They infiltrate and then tear a baby out of his mother's womb and smash his head against the wall. That's, if you look at it up, the Jesuit oath, you'll find that Francis has actually said that.
Just to interrupt, babe, just for a minute, because we've got a newcomer, Cyrus Davis. I can see you in the chat room, Cyrus. Cyrus is the son of Patrick. And then there's Vinny. So Vinny is Cyrus's brother. And how old are you, Cyrus? We'll have to...
I was on a roll there, do you mind?
Well, I want to know how old Cyrus is, because the explicit button normally goes on this program, so I want to keep it down for the sake of Cyrus.
Look.
He has a baby picture up there, and I'm wondering how old he is. Anyway, everybody's saying welcome to Cyrus, but yeah, go on, babe.
I've forgotten what I was saying.
Now, I just want to, because I'm the editor... It's 8.674 years is 3168 days.
We have then, when I'm born over Sydney, and why in Sydney? Because it's 3875 miles from the house of Rothschild Avenue, 105, which means eagle or angel. That number in the concordance is comforter. Hello. And you've got the large area of the Shroud of Turin is the image. Then you've got seven times the word comforter is found, three in the Old Testament, four in the New. You add the verse numbers up and it gives you the same number as the area of the large piece of the Shroud of Turin, which has got the old face on it, which is the old man, is 71.717629 years, to be exact. Right? We do the numbers back from the 28th of September to calculate to when the first photograph was taken by Peter. In 1898, 28th of May, and you do those numbers, and it all ties in with this miraculous way of doing things. But primarily, the space is mine, the earth is the devil's, and therefore this has got to be taken over. That's why we come to the earth, and the Lord's Prayer Day will be done on earth, because it certainly isn't now, is it? Why would you say, thy will be done on earth, if it ain't being done on earth, right? It will be done. So actually the Lord... prayer is telling you that the devil has taken over the earth. That's what it means.
Mm.
So it's just a matter of a double think about it, that's all. So just don't leave it where it is. Examine it. See what it means. Why is it saying that? Why would Jesus be saying, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven? Because it's already happened in heaven, hasn't it?
Mm.
So what's happening today, and even people logging on and coming to listen to us right now, it's already preordained that you'd be doing this. And if you look back and why and how you found us, you say, well, my brother told me, and he's been told by his father, and his father was told by someone else in the pub, and blah, blah, blah. It goes on. It's all ordained to get you here so that you can start to smarten up. We're running out of time. So we got the measurements from Jupiter. Why Jupiter? Because it's 88,800 miles across, and the word for Jesus in Greek is the Isos, and that's a value in the Greek language of 888. It's called Gematria. Assigning a letter to each number, a number to each letter of the alphabet. So that gives you 888 for the word Jesus. And of course, Jupiter is 88,800 miles across. So you take the 8880 number. And what's that? Well, that's the value of Matthew in Greek of 123, which is the Emmanuel prophecy. And the Emmanuel prophecy, the word Emmanuel means God with us. And that number is 1694. And 1694 is the height of Mount Ararat. My brother is 8.88 years older than me. And the sunrise to sunset for when he was born was 780 minutes, which is Ararat. And Ararat is 16946 feet high. So it's all a synchronicity of wonderful maneuvering of numbers. So if you're that dumb and you can't follow this, well, go fuck off and go do something else, because you're talking to God here. I can say fuck, you can't. Okay, let's get that straight.
And it's an acronym.
It's an acronym. Fornication under consent of the king, what it means. I like the word.
And Cyrus is 12.
Huh?
Cyrus is 12.
It's 12. Sorry, Cyrus. Well, these probably said it more times than I have, because I didn't say it when I was a kid.
Well, the point is, if you understand what it is, it's an acronym.
It is
God's word.
So when you go and you're upset with someone, you say, fornicate under consent of the king. Asshole. That's how you say it. Yeah, so we then have the concordance numbers. We go back to the hospital I'm born in, measure that to the South Pole, and it gives you the word God verse total. Hello? Now, all gods of the Old and New Testament are certainly not God. It's the word God that we do an account on, that's all. Right? So the God of the Jews is certainly not God of Christ. Right? Christ was God, is God, and is still God today. So the Trinity is God the Father comes to the earth in the blood of Jesus, gets nailed to a cross because of the Moses bullshit Babylonian idea entirely invented as a means for tithing and control with fear of death and making up bullshit as they go along, which had to be put to rest by the last sacrifice of the Lamb, the Son of God. Right? Not the Son of Man. Jesus was never the Son of Man, the Son of God. So he had to release the blood out of it because the Holy Ghost, which is me, conceived in Mary to give Jesus the blood on the Shroud of Turin that's got XX chromosomes, 23 of them, and one Y chromosome, which is Y as a father. That's why Jesus said to call no one father. So you go to the Catholic Church, everyone's father. Right? He's Papa, right? Which is the Pope. The new Papa. Wait a minute. Lucifer just came out of hell, which is Francis, who is not a Pope. Never will be, never was. The Pope Benedict retired. Can't retire, sorry, I told him. You can't retire, you're still a Pope. I said to him face to face, you cannot retire. You're a Pope. I put you there, that's it. So he's happy about that. And he becomes Petros Romanos. Okay. So we have the sunrise, the sunset, 8:55 minutes. Where I'm born, only, of course, in that latitude around the earth is the sunrise, the sunset at that moment. On January 11, 1944. 33 minutes later, the sun moonrise, which is 888 from sunrise to moonrise. Now, that only happens once, but it happened back in time with the Star of Bethlehem on the 17th of June 2 BC. Okay. So, what do we got? We look out in space and we measure from Jupiter out to Saturn and then all the planets inwards. Why do we do that? Well, my weight today, I'm a big man, 222 pounds. Of rippling muscle and quite gorgeous, some have been told. You know. Yeah. Where's the mirror? Oh, look, I'll check it out. Yeah, that's right, I got it. So, on those planets, I weigh the same number as the area of the Shroud of Turin. So, we've got Shroud of Turin coming up again. Then we've got the 3168. How do we get that? Well, we're measuring from Jupiter to Saturn back into the inner planets, and as I said, that's a Shroud of Turin number in weight. But the distance is 31.68 astronomical units, which is the distance average to the sun. It's an astronomical unit. So we measure out in space astronomical units for the solar system. Now, 3168 is Lord Jesus Christ in Greek Gematria. So we have New Guinea. It is under the most severe bondage of the Jews you could possibly imagine. And they're trying to kill everybody off with AIDS and malaria and all those terrible things that they've invented and spread with mosquitoes. And I was 31.68 years when I got independence on the 16th of September 1971. See where it's going? There's only a thing you can swivel your way out of, Jews. You can't get out of this. The serpent hasn't got that many moves left. All right, that's as simple as that. So Judaism is, by the words of John Strugnell, who was on the leader of the Dead Sea Scrolls interpretation people, the translation, he said Judaism was an evil little religion that should have died out 2,000 years ago. He's right. It is an evil religion. It controls and dominates and caused to be written the Quran. The Jews wrote it. Did you know that?
Hello.
So this is what we're up against. So you've got a world full of three measures of meal that has been worked into a lump of dough to make bread. unleavened bread is what you should eat, and leavened bread is when you've got the leaven in it, which is the three measures of meal that a woman took. Like, there's only one male, one father, so therefore Satan, the woman, the churches, the Jews have leavened into and given you Judaism and Christianity as a religion, which is based on the teachings of the Torah, which by secret is the Babylonian religion of the Khazar Jews out of Russia. Go back to fucking Mongolia, right? And all these Jews that think that they have a right genetically to be in Palestine is a total and utter lie. But that's what Jews do, the religion of lies. Sorry about that. If you're a Jew, you better stop being one. And if you're a Christian, you better stop sucking up to these Jews that dominate your first five books of the Bible. And even Genesis is very suspect. I mean, I haven't even read it. Like, you think I'm God, I should know all this. I don't. I don't read that shit. I never read Numbers, Deuteronomy, Leviticus, and the other one, whatever it is, or Exodus.
Exodus
is the greatest bullshit story of all time. Can you imagine wandering around? Moses is too stupid to find Jerusalem in 40 years. Hello? And he's in the middle of a desert where nothing grows. There's not even bloody ants there to eat. And the special has fed millions of people that have now been rushed out across the Dead Sea, the Red Sea. And on either side of the 14 kilometres wide...
But hey, that's the manna from heaven that fell every day. The manna from heaven.
Are you insane?
I'm telling you what's in the script.
That's bullshit.
I know. That's how...
Feed the manna and shut up, the baby's crying, right?
According to the script, that's how they survive.
What about the water?
Well, that too. And that's why Moses...
What about shit paper?
That's why Moses died, remember? Yeah. Huh? He struck the rock twice instead of once, and you got so angry with him.
Can you imagine a God being so stupid that he's going to have a man stoned to death for picking up sticks?
In a desert.
He should have been rewarded for finding sticks. That, you know? But if you pick up sticks on the Sabbath, you get stoned to death. Does that sound like me?
It all predates the Sabbath anyway.
And of course, they were all Jews. This is the whole point. Yes, they believe. Oh, forget the other bloody droids.
Oh, dearie.
So anyhow, it's all bullshit. I mean, you got the Pharisees. The Pharisees are the greatest monsters of all time. And this is of Babylon. And Babylon is where the Pharisees and Sadducees made up the idea of Moses. And they wrote the books that dominated. So therefore, blood sacrifice, the idea being that if you, say, raped a small child and you go to a high priest, you say, well, I should have done that. The high priest would have said to you, where'd you do it? Well, just down the street. Well, you should have done that, fool. You should have went to another city to do evil.
Hmm.
It is evil. The priest will say, yes, it is evil. But why did you do it there? Why not go over to some other city, like Samaria or somewhere? Do it there.
Hmm.
You can do it there and it's no problem. God doesn't see the sin.
Hmm.
All right, well, now we've got a bit of a problem because the sin is now in your blood. And how are we going to do that? Well, bring a bullet. And we'll take the blood of the bullock, and we'll put the sin, your sin, out of your blood in the bullock, because Lucifer, your God, is too fucking stupid to see the gun at your head unless you do it. Well, if I don't do it, what happens? We'll cut your throat instead. Oh, so we're going to do the bull, or the sheep, or something, chicken, dove, a couple of white ants maybe. So the blood is transferred into the animal because Lucifer, God of the Old Testament, Torah, cannot see the sin of this man in through the blood. Is that right?
Yes, yeah.
That's, I haven't read it. I haven't read it. Don't get me wrong. I haven't read the Bible.
No.
To me, the Bible is pornography. It's a spiritual pornography. In fact, there's many things in it that are pornography, which I don't want to recommend that you read, especially in Ezekiel on chapter 32. It is all insanity, people, and heaven is not where insanity is. Believe me, if you put a bullet through your head this afternoon, and I recommend it to you Jews, let's say there's a good one amongst you, and you do end up going to heaven, or on trial basis, perhaps. There ain't this bullshit up there. You don't have a Jewish section and a Catholic section and a bloody Jehovah's Witness section or a Muslim section. You don't have. You're either in or you're out. And what determines whether you're in or out is your level of innocence. So if you have a level of innocence, like, say, a small child, isn't there a verse something about that?
Yes, unless you become like a small child, you will not enter nor see the kingdom of God.
Yeah, that's right. That's either the one up there or the one down here that's coming to the earth today. Right. Now, for you on the viewing audience, we have a Bible here. Pick out any chapter. It's exactly the same as the King James original Bible. There it is right there. And guess what? It's Freemasonry. Now, go into your Google, put in Freemason Bible, and come up with the 1611 King James. Put in the God of Freemasonry and it comes up with Lucifer. When Pope Francis, I use that word very loosely, I'm just saying you know who I'm talking about. When Francis, this asshole, goes into the basilica and they're singing a song to Lucifer. If you go underneath St. Peter's, they've got 13 or 14 rooms with all of the gods of the ancients. And one room in particular has got Lucifer sitting on a white horse.
Mm.
Hello. We went to Rome. We went not into the Basilica. We didn't go into St. Peter's at all.
We did not go in.
We didn't go anywhere.
No.
We were there for a mission. That was to give confidence and trust in the fact that Pope Benedict asked us to do what we could to let the world know that he is imprisoned at the hands of Lucifer, which is the earth's representative that came straight out of hell when he was born, and that is Borgoglio, even the name Goglio, Francis. He's a man that was a broker for the Exocet missile, which killed a lot of British people in the Falklands War. He brokered $200 million worth of Exocet missiles from France for the Argentinian Navy. What do you think of that?
Very disgusting.
Can you imagine me doing that?
No.
If he was going to use them against Israel?
Well, on the other hand, we're out of time.
Are we?
There
we go again.
Do you want to play?
We made a lovely show again.
You found this phone all the way from Rome.
Yeah, we bought this phone in Rome. We bought another one over here because I didn't think it was unlocked. And it turns out it is unlocked.
And you've recorded you singing.
Well, I can't find it, but I'll put this on. Lovely little phone.
Samsung Galaxy, isn't it? Gonna be alright. Oh, there we go. But where's he singing?
Yeah, I'll sing this one. I can sing like him. He's dead. They killed him, by the way. They put a spike in his boot. When he pulled his shoe on, the spike went into his toe and he got cancer from that. And that's how they killed Bob Marley. He was very, very influential in Jamaica. His father was an Englishman.
Vinny says we're jamming. Yes, Vinny, we're just jamming. Yeah, it's happening to me. And bobbing his head backwards and forwards, isn't it? He loves to sing, for those of you who are new and haven't heard Yah sing. I want to hear you sing that. Eric and Alice say, I love the Don't Worry song. Yeah, the Don't Worry song.
Oh, is it here? I don't know whether I've got it or not.
Don't worry, weren't you just playing it before this one? Go backwards.
There's one of the best singers of all time.
Billy Eckstein. Oh, you're better than him, though.
He takes some beating. The coloured fellow was very popular, supposed to have had the best singing voice of all time, which I agree with. He was prior to people like Frank Sinatra. Had his own band. Okay, so that's...
go back before. But don't worry, be happy, so. That's you. Yes, this is Jan now, guys. Crooning to his phone. Elvis.
We bought this phone in Italy. It's a Samsung. And they don't lock them apparently in Europe, because you go from one country to another with your phone and you want to use your local SIM card, then if they're locked, you've got a problem.
Beats that Chinese thing that we've thing we've been struggling with from here. Pathetic.
So it's a Samsung Galaxy. It's in a small phone. It's about right. It does everything you want. And
Listen.
Me sing?
Yes, you sing.
Yeah.
I got all shy.
Shucks, me, I'm you. Know how to embarrass a guy. Who's this?
The day that we wed, you blessed us with sin.
This is Marty Robbins. Most famous song that Marty Robbins came out with.
Is this the El Paso?
Oh, Mary. I told her about a great sin. Mary cried and forgave me.
All right, now, I think we're going to... No miming. I like the Fijian wedding song. One of the greatest men that ever lived was Elvis Presley. Loved singing gospel and totally non-racist, not like me. And would help anybody pay for their hospital bills and do what they could, buy all his friends a Cadillac and all this kind of stuff.
Loved his mum, yes. Great.
He was born one of a twin. His twin brother died.
Aaron.
I went to Memphis and went through the tour. You get on a tour bus across in across from the main house. So you get in this tour bus, it costs $7, and the tour bus drives across the road, gates open, drive in, you get out. That's it, the shortest tour of all time. It's about 150 feet. So all these people go trunching through Elvis's house and upstairs, downstairs, and all that kind of stuff. And it's got a squash court out the back, and then there's a little grave site there, memorial to his mother and his father and his brother and himself. And as we're all lined up, the only remaining relative was an old grand lady, must have been his aunt. And she walks out on the balcony looking down over the people as they're strolling through. And someone says, look, he's got blue suede shoes on. I didn't think that was appropriate. I'm standing in front of Elvis's grave at the time.
Of course, we found Elvis in Castle Maine, didn't we?
We did. Very much like him. Big man, taller than me. And looked like Elvis and had a band. Because he sang like Shirley Bassey. That's not true.
No, we were contemplating, because knowing how much Elvis loved Jesus, and we were singing Milky Way, Milky White Way, all the time. And I said to Yar one day, you know, Elvis really loved you. He must be here, close to you, somewhere.
And this guy walks into the cafe, just as she said it, and he said, "You wasn't the trouble."
No, we'd declared the kingdom at Harcourt already, and then looking around at property.
So it's Australia. It's the holy city of Australia.
Yes. And looking at a beautiful property that I wanted to see, so I rang the realtor and organised to meet him at the local general store where Tricia happened to work, and his name...
Lovely lady.
What was his name? Robertson. Somebody Robertson. But anyway, he walked in, and this was just within days of me saying he has to be here somewhere close. He walked in, and he was Elvis. He had the sideburns, he had everything, a slick back, black hair, tall, wearing an overcoat. And
what?
I just looked up at him and said, you know what everybody says, you've got to be Elvis. And he says, everybody says that. However, it was only the day before, Sunday, he was cleaning out his garage and he found a poster of Elvis and he unrolled it and put it on his living room wall the day before. So when anything goes on a living room wall, it usually comes to pass. It's alive, as all my paintings did. Once I named them and hung them in the living room. Oh, my darling. Oh, your touch. Anyway, Elvis showed us around this beautiful property called Jindara Springs. And I launched. He was very patient. And I think he still watches. He was watching us for a long time after that.
Well, you told him everything, so he's... Top guy, he's Australian, so he's intelligent. Mm. And looked like Elvis, so he's got a bit intelligent. Does Elvis in First Nations, so he's got a bit intelligent. Yeah, so you launched and told him what was going on. I said, well.
Those videos are still out there somewhere. The property's magnificent. All you can hear is my voice launching to Elvis as we're riding around it. What was the golf cart, wasn't it?
It was like a little utility type thing with a pickup back on it, but you could stand up or put heaps of sheep shit in or whatever you want to move around. And two people could sit in the front.
104 acres under grapes as a vineyard, the rest with dams, a beautiful property.
So as I'm walking on the property looking at it, I'm taking a video of everything, and I come around to the front of it, and there's this just simply magnificent. And then there's a devil's head built into the brick wall.
Mm. People are so stupid today. They take these things and I don't know what it is, ignorance or just no...
Oh, they're Freemasons, that's what it's all about.
But
see, the higher up in the Freemasons you go, the more you become familiar with what the actual God is, and it's all to do with devil worship and child sacrifice and all this kind of stuff, the higher up you go. So that's why your military in America, it goes back many, many years, but just to the Vietnam War, there was always betting on how many bodies would be killed that week. Mm. So the generals would manoeuvre bombing raids over their own people and kill their own soldiers.
Mm.
They called it friendly fire.
Yes.
But they was betting on that. And General Haig, he was very principled in that. He was a personal friend of Lyndon Baines Johnson.
Mm.
Now, Kennedy got killed because he was going to pull everybody out. So the military might, which was all controlled by the Pentagon, which is the contracts they give out to the various weapons manufacturers, which is big, big, big business.
Mm.
Right. And a big, big, big business is Jewish. And that's what controls where the war machine goes.
Mm.
Right? So Kennedy, he made a brilliant speech. You might be able to look it up. Just look up the speech that occurred about 9 or 10 months prior to him being shot. So he got shot in 1962, November the 22nd.
63.
November 22nd. So go back about 9 months and you'll see some of the speeches at that time. But he made this most brilliant speech because what he was is one of the most brilliant orators of speeches. He actually held a world record for how many words per minute in a speech.
Mm.
Mind you, you got him beat by about 24%.
Hello.
Yeah, so 300 or so words per minute he could say in a speech, but it's got to be audible. You just can't blurt it out. But that's how you determine, you know, a good speech presenter in being able to say things in an audible fashion. And the speech has got to be able to manoeuvre through the thought process of the morons it's listening to.
Mm.
So it's got to be articulate. And he had the world record for that.
Mm.
Over 300 words a minute.
Wonderful.
He's also a very ill man. And was on all sorts of drugs because of this illness that he had as a youngster. And a very, very thin man, and made him fatter as he got older. And very, very bad back as well. And having an affair with Marilyn Monroe. And Marilyn Monroe, she was professing the idea that she's going to be the first lady.
Mm.
Next thing, he runs off with a Jewish woman, Jacqueline Onassis. Turns out to be like when she married Onassis after she died. So, yeah, so it's a big, you can see the pattern is always the same. There's always got a Jew in the Barbie, so to speak. And, we're just about out of here, aren't we?
Yeah, well, I'm just looking at
the time.
Do you
want to talk to these people about?
Well, I'll just go through what the guys have been talking about. They've been having their own conversation.
Not listening? Blasphemy!
Cyrus says Kennedy was a good president but was killed by the Jews. Yes, he was. They all are. They're all, well, Jewry controls.
Well, Abraham Lincoln
the Jew
was
world
a Jew.
Order.
Hello, did you
it's
know
not
that?
The New World Order, it's the Jew World Order. Herod says animals love Yahweh, the mojo is rubbing off because Mark was planting some cannabis beside a river and had a robin come and watch him.
Who come and watch him?
A robin, was it?
A robin.
A bird come and sit and watch him. Yes, animals do love Yahweh. Now, what was interesting, just really... Oh. That's right. Uh-huh. What's the name of the dog in Papua New Guinea?
Dog.
Diana and Maro. When we first got there, the strange behaviour.
Mongrel.
No, Pia, wasn't it? Or some Pia. Yes. It didn't take long for him to get over whatever was annoying him, but... yes, so guys...
I like how you pull these things out of the blue and no one knows what to talk
well,
about.
I was reading some of the comments of the guys talking about animals loving you, and then I remember the reaction of Pia, which was totally strange. Talking about 24 hours to get
right.
over his but he'd been attacked by a strange dog. Abraham Lincoln was a Jew, yes, question mark by Vinny. Yeah, they're all Jews. The infiltration, of course it all started when the Jews were allowed back in England, 1649, and that was Oliver Cromwell, the greatest traitor to all, well no, he's not the greatest traitor, but certainly a traitor to all England. He's right up there. Francis is the greatest traitor of all time. today. He's the Antichrist.
Right, absolutely.
Not allowing the news to go
out. He's running a close second, I think, to Pope John Paul II.
Hmm.
When he came to Australia, I had inadvertently gone down to what a place is called the Paddy's Markets, like the big market stalls in Sydney. They're a huge, big warehouse, which was originally dock warehouses. And since the container ships come in, this has all kind of changed and changed. But people set up their wares for sale at Paddy's Market. And very old. And traffic was everywhere. I had horrors about that. So I actually found a place to park in Hay Street. Just as I was driving past, it's like you can't get a parking spot for about 10 miles radius. And there's this car pulling out, so I went straight in. Got out the car, walked to the end, and all these people are standing there waiting for something or other. Something was happening. The next thing, around the corner comes a Pope Bill with John Paul II out. And he locked eyes on me and froze without able to move his eyelids. And as he went past, his eyes just kept fixed on me, and he slowly turned, staring at me, slowly going past, and he looked absolutely terrified, because he was... See, Lucifer gets into these people. Remember, God creates, and Lucifer occupies the created. So that is why you could have Lucifer in one pope, and then another pope comes along and be Lucifer in him. But just move, the deity moves from one point to the other. So when we're talking about in your book of Revelation, and you've got the devil coming out of the, or Lucifer coming out of the bottomless pit, where's it going to? Well, it's got to occupy somewhere. It's not just floating around. It's got to occupy somebody. And who did it occupy? Well, of course, it was Pope John Paul II. And then, now, the biggie is Francis. And he is occupied by Lucifer. In your book of Revelation, look up 17:11. You got seven popes, one of the seven becomes the eighth. So, naturally, the only one that was left alive was Benedict at that time, and he retired. And I said to the Pope, you can't retire. So you are still Pope. So that still is the one Pope. Francis doesn't count in the Pope lineup because it was illegal. Once the Pope recognises the first time in history that Christ is back on the earth and makes a public statement about it, then the conclave had to come to a screaming halt. And you occupied the internet for days, contacting all of the nuns in Rome and New York.
So it was
and
the cardinals. I had responses from them.
Yes.
One
cardinal had to know. All they do is tell the others, hey, Pope Benedict said
Christ is back.
There were
several cardinals that knew because it was...
Exactly.
What's his name? Dolan out of New York. Timothy Dolan out of New York.
Monster.
That I sent through to his personal email after having a conversation with his personal assistant, Kathleen, and I told her the news, and she gave me the personal email for Dolan while he was in Rome, and he was the self-appointed spokesperson for all of the cardinals. Not only that, I faxed it through to PAC College, the College of Cardinals in Rome. So they all had the information, Vatican Radio, Vatican Media, they all knew. Everybody had the information. So
RAI-TV.
The conclave was illegitimate. It should have stopped immediately.
If it turned out to be that I was full of nonsense, when you have a Pope say, I have met the Christ, he's back on the earth, blah, 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 you have to investigate it. Well, they investigated it right long before that. The only one that was out of the loop was Pope Benedict. Right? All the others knew. They're going ahead. They want to bring their devil in, right? Of course they did. That's why it's a Jesuit, straight out of hell. Jesuits are straight out of hell. The Jesuit oath. Look it up. Read it. It's appalling. This is what all
it's
Jesuits...
Totally Talmud.
Totally, totally Jewish. So they end up with a black Pope, a Jew, in charge of the Vatican. But we got in that much before by having the conclave start after Pope Benedict recognised me. And that's the end
of it. Well, it started the same day. He announced it the day they...
Yeah, but I was talking to the day
he
before.
He announced, yes, and he announced the day before the election of Francis, which was the day of the convening of the conclave. So,
see, Pope Benedict should have been screaming right then, but he's such a nice fella, which is pathetic in a way. I don't like nice people. I like hard people to do the job right. Yeah, kill him, right? Get on with it. And that's what I say to the angels. Angels aren't nice. So you take them out. We're in a war of babies being sacrificed day after day after day, and the Pope didn't know it. Pope Benedict didn't know anything about it. So he had a very misguided appreciation of what Christ is supposed to be. And he thinks Jesus is coming back because he called me Jesus. I'm not, I'm God. The Comforter. That's why I'm going back to all that stuff I was raving on about before, the 3875 number. Look it up in the Concordance. Go online and look up the Concordance in the Blue Bible, I think it's called. You can find it in there. They've added words to it, so don't get too upset if you find there's too many words in it. But the point is, you look up the word Comforter, and you'll get the verses. Add the seven verses together. You've got three in the Old Testament and four in the New Testament. Add all the verses up as numbers. Like the last one is John 16:7, for example. Add that up as a number, 16.7. And you'll find that it comes up with this number 6754, which is the area of the larger Peter, the Shroud of Turin. So that's got the Comforter on it. That's what I'm saying to you. I'm the Comforter, the old man, the 71-year-old face that is on the white-haired face. That is, oh, Jesus, look at that, he's got white hair. No, no. It's the soul that burned the image. Jesus didn't burn the image. The soul was going back to cover the outside of Jesus. That's why when you go in and stay the Shroud of Turin, that there is a burn mark on both sides of the shroud and blood on the inside of the shroud. So where the body is now imprinted onto the shroud, it's in a reverse image. So the spear went into the right side on the image, but it's actually on the left side because the soul goes in the same way as it came out. Goes that way out from the cross and that way in to the blood. That's why the blood had to be covered all over it. Why? Because the blood is where now the soul resides on the outside. There's no blood on the inside. At first came out blood and then water, spirit inside. That's what that verse means, nothing else. That's the whole meaning of it. So there's no blood left in the body. So the blood on the outside is where the soul resides, on the outside. Hello?
I want you to clarify something. I'm just looking at this. This needs to be clarified. Herod is right when he says Cain goes back to Adam because Herod has been listening to Yah's explanation and teachings.
Parable? It's a parable?
Now, and then Mark says, no, their father is the devil's serpent. Adam fell. Cain was the seed of Adam. Adam is responsible for the fall. It was Adam's sin. Because the instruction to not eat or don't put your hand on the
cockroach. Don't crush that cockroach.
Don't crush the cockroach. Yeah, anything. It was a simple instruction for Adam.
Because he did it.
Not Eve. But Eve was not on the scene. Eve was not on the scene when the command was given to Adam.
The serpent come out of Adam.
And Cain was a result. Cain was a result of.
Think of the words.
The intercourse.
The serpent is described as being the most intelligent, most supple of the animals, right? But in actual fact, Adam was the most intelligent. So it came out of the mind, the serpent, the Jews come out of the mind of Adam. That's the start of your Jews. Right there. The idea was in the mind of Adam. Therefore, the Jew come out of Adam, which is the serpent, which is what's represented today by totally enclosing the earth in its mouth, biting its tail. That's what it's all about. If you look up in astronomy and they talk about the predictions of the Mayan calendar, all that kind of thing, it's a serpent going around the Milky Way galaxy and grabbing its tail. Huh? The serpent are the Jews.
Right. Now, what did Jesus say?
You are of your father, the devil.
Right. Which came from Cain the first murderer, but Cain was the seed of Adam after he fell.
That's right.
Disobedience.
Killed Abel, his blood cries out from the ground. The blood is the soul, cries out from the ground. So then we've got Eve is rewarded by having another baby, and that comes from God. Look it up.
No Adam involved.
And it becomes the Seth line. Seth lived 912 years. The average age of all patriarchs, down to Noah, is 912 years. I was 9 pounds 12 when I was born. That's a coincidence. Hello? The age of all these people put together is 912 years average, and the names, when added up in Hebrew, Gematria, that's assigning a number to each of the Hebrew letters of the names, is 3168. Lord Jesus Christ in Greek Gematria, or the distance out from Jupiter to the planets, out to Saturn and back into the Sun, 31.68 astronomical units when I was born. Chandler, if you were to put all this information into a super cray computer, it probably wouldn't have answered it. This is such a stupid question. But if it did, was forced to answer, I'd say, of course it's in. Get on with it. We're all morons. How do you fix it? Get rid of all the Jews. Oh, yeah. Hitler was right. I'm very upset with Hitler. He gets blamed for doing what he didn't do. And the Germans, today in Germany, and we know this for a fact because we was there and we checked it out, that booklets are handed out to little children going to the kindergarten to show how the parents should masturbate them. A few days ago, we see where they're bringing in laws where child pornography is okay. And pornography and child molestation is okay. This is Germany. You can see how the most righteous country. Hitler knew. He said, if you don't stop these bastards, and he wasn't strong enough to do anything about it. He should have just fixed it right then and there. You take all the children away from the Jews, you put all the adults in a cage somewhere, and don't let them out. It's called sentencing or capital punishment. You don't have to kill them, just lock them up. And all the children you educate properly. Give me a child up until the age of 7 and he's mine forever, right? So you educate the children. That's all it's all about. Doesn't matter whether you're a Mongolian or not. Right? There's Christian Mongolians too, you know? So it's got nothing to do with genetics from that point of view, except the fact that the lies of Judaism are so entrenched in everything I do must be a lie. If the lips are moving, it's a lie. That simple. They are forbidden to tell the truth. Forbidden. It's forbidden. So if you want to, I've done this with Jews. I ask them questions where they are forced to say the opposite of what they want to say, and which then exposes them as being, because when you're talking to me, I can be very, very sly and quick and catch people off guard. I do it all the time. And Jews are easy to talk to. You ask them a question they don't want to answer, and you can see by looking in their face, right? Easy. So anyhow, they are forced to lie, so you can make them lie to answer a truth, because they're pretty naive and stupid. Jews are pretty stupid people. Now, they do force their sons and daughters to become lawyers and doctors and everything else, and that goes to show how really stupid that the world is for letting them be in a case where they can determine your politics, laws, and what medication you're under. Because you go back to 1492, this was the advice that came out of Constantinople by the Prince of the Jews. Now, in 1492, all the Jews were getting kicked out of Spain. Why? Because they were eating Christian children. They were bleeding them to death, drinking their blood. And much, much worse things that you can't even say in front of children. But that's what you're up against. I know it. I'm God, I'm going to fix it, whether you like it or not. I don't care whether you agree or not. It doesn't make any difference to me. If you're that stupid, you just join the queue. The Jews lining up over there, go join them. Because Christianity is another form of Judaism, that's all. The Muslims are another form of Judaism. You go into the Abraham story, and this is where it's all based on. It comes from Ur of Chaldee. Hello, there's Babylon in it. Right, but if you go up into the mountains of Ararat, you find the blue-eyed people all spread out from there. I guarantee you, Abraham didn't have blue eyes. He's an Arab. See what I'm saying? It's all bullshit. All of it is bullshit. If you're in a court and you've got a judge and you've got a witness, and a witness is caught out in one lie by a lawyer, you say, right, throw all his testimony out and charge him with perjury. The Bible is bullshit. So all I'm trying to do is showing you that there are things in the Bible that have numbers associated with them that the Jews didn't know anything about when they changed the wording of it. And it just happened to change the wording to reveal the numbers of their own subversive behaviour in changing the verse in the first place. And even where the source is, which is the Essene, no one ever said Jesus is an Essene in the Bible, did they? But he was. And where did he come from? Where did the family come from? England. That's not in there either. But you got Constantine married an English woman. Why is that? His mother, I think, was from England as well. Hello. Then you got the Irish line. In Ireland, everyone knows the story. It's the Irish line of kings. It goes down to the Scottish line of kings, which is my aunt family, of course, all of it, through my mother. And it's common knowledge in Ireland, in Scotland. It's only when you get down to the English-dominated Bible that they don't mention where Jesus' family came from. Amazing, amazingly stupid. So you've got all the churches of the world all raving on the same thing because they're totally dominated by the Jews. Well, it has to stop. Look, if you blew your brains out and you went up to heaven, you wouldn't expect to be a whole lot of bunch of Jews up there, would you? Why would you have the most evil bastards on earth in heaven? No, where are they? They're in hell. And you're in hell, brother. Make sense? Well, that's what it's all about. So, no homosexuals, no lesbians, no dildos. I'll take them off eBay. And all of the evil things that you have been exposed to and on this earth, pornography and filthy movies. We've got Netflix now, and we're looking at the movies. You can't watch nothing. It is all totally disgusting. Homosexuals and homosexual this and homosexual that, and lesbians, and two women become lesbians after her husband found out they're gay. All that. Oh, Jesus, it goes on forever. Of course, you've got the war movies where the poor Jews have been set upon. Now, the biggest mafia in America is Jewish. Russian mafia, Jewish. Russian government, Jewish. 60 million died in the First World War. Christians. Killed by the Jews. The royal family of Russia was killed by the Jews. So on that happy note. Anything else you got to address there?
Mark's, Sarah says, thanks Obama for your incompetence in this. Well, it's a little bit deeper than incompetence.
Not incompetence, he's very clever.
But he's a homosexual and his wife is a transgender and he's all part of the gross evil. Mark's just quoting Dr. Abba Hittel Silver, a Jew, writing in the Jewish publication 1949, The Curse of Cain, The Curse of Being an Outcast, and the face of the earth has been removed. They're off the earth. So that's the curse that they face next. Cast out of the kingdom which has come to the earth because the King of Kings is here. And, all right. It's Cyrus, I just want to explain something. You're a 12-year-old boy. And begin to occupy your mind with the things of the future, the things that you would
like to see
within a paradise controlled by God. I can see that you have a lot of knowledge and truth there that you have picked up. And it's our job. I want to make this really clear. It's our job to say what we say in revealing the truth. And we're speaking it to the enemy who are listening to every word that we say. And we also speak it for the sake of the holy angels who listen to every word that we say. They pick up. And this, as Yah has said before, if nobody else in the world listened, he would still upload, because it's for the holy angels and for the enemy, the Jews who call themselves Jews and are not, to hear what it is that we are saying. So we speak the way we do, it's aimed at the enemy. And your role, all of you here, everybody in the chat room now, go on about your business and focusing on the future. Right? It's all good for the good. And it's our job to reveal all things and to call them out. Our job. Other than that, anybody who treats you with respect face to face and wherever you are, you return that respect.
Providing it's not a Jew, if it is,
I don't know, it's kind of unsettling. I understand. But
never
young children.
Trust a Jew. Never, ever, 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 and another ever on the end of that, trust a Jew. It's their religion to lie and cheat you. Everything you own is theirs. And they are told they must take it from you by some subversive means.
Talmud.
It's all Talmud.
All right, way overdue again. 35 minutes past the hour. All right, guys, thank you for being so active in the chat room. And let's keep this fire going, just spreading the links and all the rest of it, see where it goes. Burning, burning, burning. Burning the gross darkness. And we'll be back tomorrow, 96 minutes. Day of the Resurrection. All right, guys, later, gators.